Good morning, church. I invite you to rise as you are able and turn your attention towards the font, which is the place we encounter Christ in our lives and where we begin our worship service this morning. Blessed be God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, whose forgiveness is sure and whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Together, let us honestly and humbly confess that we have not lived as God desires. Loving and forgiving God, we confess that we are held captive by sin. In spite of our best efforts, we have gone astray. We have not welcomed the stranger. We have not loved our neighbor. We have not been Christ to one another. Restore us, O God. Wake us up and turn us from our sin. Renew us each day in the light of Christ. Amen. People of God, hear this glad news. By God's endless grace, your sins are forgiven and you are free. Free from all that holds you back and free to live in the peaceable realm of God. May you be strengthened by God's love, comforted by Christ's peace, and accompanied by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, our gathering hymn this morning is Come Now, O God. It's found on the next page of your bulletins or up on the screens. Friends, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. During the season of Advent, we watch and wait for Christ's coming, and so we gather at this evergreen wreath to light the candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer. Now, today is the fourth Sunday in Advent. It's the Sunday of love. We light this fourth candle as a remembrance that the coming of the Messiah, Jesus, showed the world what love truly looked like. It's a love that sets principles aside, a love that treasures the otherness of each individual, a love that forgives, and a love that is self-sacrificing. It's the love that Christ showed us, reflecting the love of our Heavenly Father, and it's the love that we are called to show one another. Come, Emmanuel, come. Hear the words of love spoken by God in Isaiah. The Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, Hear then, O house of David, Is it too little for you to weary mortals that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. And let us pray. God of hope, Prince of peace, Jubilee judge and Lord of love, your goodness is beyond our wildest imaginings. You give us more than we can think to ask, coming to us with impossible possibility in the union of flesh and spirit. Teach us to love this world and all people as you love us in Jesus Christ our Lord. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness come. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. With your abundant grace and might, free us from the sin that would obstruct your mercy, that willingly we may bear your redeeming love to all the world. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you. Yes, now. Good morning, St. Philip's. This reading is from the Old Testament, second book of Samuel, chapter 7, verses 1 to 11 and 16. Now, when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent. Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Whenever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. an evildoer shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me, and your throne shall be established forever. The word of the Lord. The responsorial psalm is Psalm 89, verses 1 to 4 and 19 to 26. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David. I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. Then you spoke in a vision to your faithful one and said, I have set the crown on one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found my servant David. With my holy oil I have anointed him. My hand shall always remain with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name his horn shall be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. The New Testament lesson is from Romans chapter 16, verses 25 to 27. Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words, and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and in his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And then the angel departed from her. And this is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Hey, Patrick, our favorite pastor. Just who we were hoping to see. Their favorite. Just who they were hoping for. The truth is, in that moment, I was flattered by their welcome. I really was. It was back when St. Philip's was a much smaller congregation, less demands on my time day to day. And I was well known for when I would be out visiting someone in a neighborhood. If I knew somebody else was in that neighborhood from our congregation, I'd kind of just swing by, see if they were there, I'd knock on the door. Wouldn't go in necessarily, but wouldn't look to anyway, but just say, "Hey, how you doing?" And it was clear that Russ and Mary, names changed to protect the innocent, were happy to see me. Just who we were hoping to see, they said. I felt special by their greeting. You might even say I felt favored by it. Favored to have shown up like I did and to have been received like I did. It really is too bad at that moment that my spidey senses weren't going off a little bit, because I innocently replied, "Well, you know, I was in the neighborhood, so I just thought I'd stop in and see how you were doing." "Well, we're glad you stopped," they said. "We could use your help." And I replied, "I'm happy to help." Russ promptly showed me down to his basement where he had been working on his furnace. Russ, a few years older than me, said he needed to get a wrench in there, he said, and just turn that connection, just loosen the nut so the condensation runoff line could be removed. Sound familiar, Pastor John? Yeah, you're with me. Now, I noticed that as I leaned down, it was at a weird angle, and it was really dusty and dirty down there where I had to lay down and get underneath of, you know, whatever all that was, because I don't know HVAC at all. The good news is I was able to turn that coupling very easily. The bad news, oh, by the way, did I mention I was dressed in my nice clothes that day? Collar, my nice slacks, nice shoes. The reason that Russ was removing all of this is that the runoff line was backed up with dust and grit and grime. Well, when I turned that connection, the water just flowed out of there, flooded right out, splashed everywhere, all over me, and they were so apologetic. But it definitely crossed my mind in that moment. That feeling I had of being favored and special, yeah, it comes with a cost. Comes with a cost. I hadn't thought of that story in a long, long time. It was a long time ago. But I thought of that story when I read today's gospel lesson, when I read the way that the angel Gabriel greets Mary in this scene, the Annunciation. Because there was something about this story that I never noticed before. I have never noticed that when it says that Mary is perplexed, that she is perplexed by Gabriel's greeting, not his presence. She is perplexed, not that Gabriel has shown up, but it is the way that he greets her. And that has stayed with me all week long. And it stayed with me because most of the time in Scripture, when these heavenly beings, these angels show up, people are terrified. We're going to see that on Christmas Eve, just a few days from now, when the angels show up for the shepherds who are out tending their flocks by night. We're going to be told that when the angels show up, the shepherds are terrified. Or like the guards at Jesus' tomb after he has died. When the angel shows up, the guards are there, and we're told that when they see the angels, they are terrified. I've always just assumed, as I kind of read past these words, that Mary's response is the same thing. That her perplexedness is because she was scared at Gabriel's presence. But Luke tells us specifically that after Gabriel greets her with pretty magnanimous words, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you," we are told that Mary was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. What sort of greeting indeed? Was he kidding? Was he mocking her? Was he being ironical? Was the angel setting her up like Russ and Mary, whether they knew it or not, getting me in to help with the furnace? Were they kind of inviting them into something that was unexpected? We don't know all the reasons Mary may have been perplexed. But the moment you stop and think about it, you realize that the possibilities are many. From her circumstances to her socioeconomic level, from her gender and her age, to her life experience or lack thereof up to that point in her life. So many reasons to doubt the sincerity of the angel's greeting and perhaps not to understand it at all. But perhaps the one possibility that doesn't even occur to Mary until Gabriel continues is that he's serious. That she is favored and that the Lord is with her. Because this whole arrangement is going to be really difficult on her. From the fact of being engaged to Joseph, she faces Joseph potentially walking away from her. She faces, frankly, potentially being stoned for her unfaithfulness. She faces being shunned at the very least for being an unwed mother that she was about to be at this point. I mean, it's not like single moms at that time can just take advantage of daycare options and go out and get a job. And I'm not even sure that she understands what it means that this child is going to be Jesus. What that all entails. I mean, does she get that her entire family is about to be exiled to Egypt because of the threat of King Herod? And then, of course, there is all that will ultimately happen to Jesus, that she will watch with her own eyes and her own broken heart. Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you. Yeah, I imagine she isn't just a little bit perplexed. And here's the thing. I don't think that Mary is the only one who struggles to believe that she is favored and that God is with her. Particularly as we've been hearing and saying over the course of 2020, after the year that we have had, I think a whole lot of people would scoff in disbelief or shake their heads in doubt, perplexed if we were given this same kind of greeting. You too might struggle with the notion that God favors you or me after the year that we've had. The economic hardship, the political strife before and after the election, a new and sharper awareness of longstanding racial injustice, a promise of a vaccine, even as hospitalizations and deaths surge to new and devastating highs. The list goes on and on. And all of it contributes to having a hard time believing the announcement of the angel and the promise of God favoring us, let alone Mary. I think it is particularly and painfully difficult for us to believe that God favors us and is with us. And the results of that difficulty are as common as they are tragic. I think about not just the things that we have all commonly experienced this year, but I started this week thinking back on individual people that I have met and talked with through this year. Like a woman that I met who struggles with the difference between intimacy and relationship. And she lives in this quiet fear of voicing any need or any hope or any desire to her partner because she fears that she risks disappointment or desertion. Or a middle-aged man that I met who is really, he's the picture of success. He's an executive. Picture of success in every way that you could think about it. Except for the fact that he can't seem to shake the addiction that he is too ashamed to admit or address. I met this year a gay teenager who has confessed to thinking about suicide nearly every day because she doesn't feel accepted for who she is. I met a black man who was a parent, who tells me that in today's racially stressed culture, every single day his black son leaves the house. He feels afraid for his son's life. Different scenarios, different levels of opportunity, challenge, and privilege, to be sure. The same struggle to believe that we are favored, that we have value and dignity simply for who we are, and that God is with us and for us. So much in life suggests that this isn't true, can't be true, will never be true, and that perplexity and doubt colors our view of ourselves and those around us. And then there's Mary. That with all her questions, that with all that perplexes her, she is still able to respond, "Here am I, let it be done with me according to your word." How could she respond that way with all of her doubts and with all of her questions and all that perplexes her? That was the question that I hung on to all week. Until it occurred to me that I guess it must be that she knows something about this God. Before the angel even shows up, she already knows something about God. And it's that she already trusts something about God. She already knows something about the unconditional love of God, so that even suspecting, knowing, feeling in a way that her life is about to be turned upside down, she can still say, "Yes, here am I. Let it be with me according to your word." It is the same thing that you and I have to know about God to get through a year like this. It's the same thing that each of those individuals that I talked about need to know about God, whether they do or not, need to know about God to get through their every single day. That for all the ups and downs of life, God does favor us. God does regard us. He knows us and loves us and treasures us and never lets go of us. As I said before, so much in life suggests this isn't true, can't be true, never be true, and that perplexity and doubt will forever color our view of ourselves and those around us. But faith speaks into these times and invites us to trust and to hope and to live our lives firm in the faith that God favors us and dwells with us always. Firm in the faith that the same promise given to Mary that day is given to you as well. Greetings, all of you favored ones. The Lord is with you. That promise is as true in these stories of Jesus' birth as it is in the stories of Jesus' death on the cross, that in the midst of what seems grim and hopeless, God dwells there and brings new life always. Greetings, you favored one. The Lord is with all of you. Amen. Friends, why don't we stand and sing together?
Prayers of the Church. God of power and might, tear open the heavens and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. Gracious God, all generations call you blessed. In this holy season, we pray for our neighbors of other denominations and faiths. Inspire the faith of their people. Cultivate understanding among us and strengthen us in love and service to our community. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Creator God, you scatter the proud. Everything we have belongs first to you. Bless and protect the seas, mountains, plains, forests, skies, and soils that surround us. Give us humility as we tend. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Righteous God, you humble the powerful and lift up the lowly. We pray for the leaders of all nations, that they amplify the voices of people in need. Guide all people entrusted with leadership to create societies in which everyone can flourish. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, you fill the hungry with good things and send the rich away empty. Nourish those who lack access to adequate food and nutrition. Bless the work of advocates, community organizers, and food pantries. Encourage others to provide for their neighbors in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Healing God, you pour out mercy to all who cry out to you. Surround everyone in need of healing, in body, mind, or spirit, with your tender presence. We pray for especially Ron Henry, Russ Hokeson, Charlie Young, Danny Mason, Judy Parsons, Sherry Thompson, Dana Hauser, John and Barb Williams, Dave Frampton, Ruth Bowles, Kelly Kraft, Joe and Lynn Pauser, Lois Hardy, Marge Davis, Nelson and Diane Murray, Trudy Gilgengast, John Newcomer Sr., Del Lenker, Colby Sturck and family, Lenore Hoffman, Carol Ruckel, Kevin Richard Pierce, Carol Goodman, Bill Cox, Marion Santak and family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. At this time, everyone in the congregation is invited to offer your own prayers, either aloud or in your hearts. David Lynch. Eternal God, you are faithful to the promises you made to our forebears. We give thanks for the ministry of Katharina von Bora Luther and other ancestors who organized, planned, dreamed, encouraged, and reached out as they served you. We give thanks for the bold leadership of female leaders in our own time. Inspire others with their steadfast witness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share God's peace with one another with an elbow bump, a peace sign, and for those who are watching with us, receive our peace as well.
Well, friends, good morning. Welcome to St. Philip's Lutheran Church, where our mission is to make disciples, praise God, and serve the community. Great to see you this morning. Great to have you worshiping with us, whether you're here in person or online joining us. Couple of quick announcements. Of course, Christmas is upon us. All Christmas gifts that folks signed up to donate to Hilltop, thank you so much for doing that. Just amazing generosity. Huge pile of gifts out there. So thank you so much for that. All gifts needed to have been turned in or need to be turned in by like 11:30 today. The youth are taking them down to Hilltop at noon today. So that'll give us time to kind of load them in and get them down there. So if you're online, speed up here quickly after worship. If you're here, I don't know what to tell you. Go home, grab them, bring them back, whatever. The other thing with Christmas coming later this week is worship on Christmas Eve. Most of the slots are filled up. There might be a few left. If you've not signed up, and if you know me, it pains me to say this, if you've not signed up, you'll be worshiping from home remotely. You can pick it up on our live stream. If you did sign up and plans have changed and you're not coming, please take your name off so that other people might be able to squeeze in still. We are capped by the governor at our number. Can't go over it. So, you know, if you signed up, great. We'll see you then. If you didn't, we'll catch you online. So if you have questions about that, need help signing up, deleting, whatever, see me, and I can help you out with that. John, you got a couple of things looking past Christmas
to January. Yeah, so starting on January 10th, our large group Bible study programming is going to start up for this new program year. We're going to be meeting in the social hall in a socially distant fashion from 9:15 to 10:15. We're going to be working through a program entitled, What Does the Small Catechism Have to Say in a Time of COVID-19? So if you are interested, 9:15 to 10:15 in the social hall, it's going to be about a seven-week program. For those who want to participate from afar, we are going to be live streaming it. Whichever pastor is not going to be presenting that day is going to monitor the chat on the live stream so you can ask questions in real time, get answers in real time. But looking forward to getting that started again. Also happening in January, we're going to be starting another semester of Uncomfortable Conversations with a Black Man. That is going to be held on Thursday evening starting January 7th. We're going to be gathering via Zoom from 6:30 to 8, and that's going to be going from January 7th through February 11th. So there is a sign-up genius in the back of the bulletin. There's a link that you can click on if you've got it on your tablet or phone. It's also in the guidepost, so be on the lookout for that to show up. But sign up early, sign up often. But at this time, we would normally be getting our gifts of offering. You guys have done an amazing job of putting that in the basket in the back, of sending things in via mail, sending things online for automatic donation. But we're going to continue with our worship service, so I'd invite you to rise as you are able. And let us pray together. Gracious God, you have created all that is, and you provide for us in every season. Bless all that we offer. Through these gifts, the world will receive your blessing. In the name of Jesus, Emmanuel, we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and ever-living God. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new, in that day when he comes again to judge the world in righteousness. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Are you, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, for he is Emmanuel, God with us. Fulfilling the expectation of the prophets, he healed the blind and the lame, cleansed the lepers, opened the ears of the deaf, raised the dead, and brought good news to the poor. Through his life, death, and resurrection, you manifest your new covenant with humankind, and through the church of his disciples, you give testimony to the power of your salvation for the world. For in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, in remembrance of all your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we give ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for the world as we declare together, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, gathered here out of love for you, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Let the bread we break be true fellowship in the body of Christ, and let the cup we share be true participation in the new covenant of his blood. By your Spirit, empower us to be Christ in the world, serving in his name, until the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the seas. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, gathered together by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Even as we watch and wait, Christ is here. Come, eat, and drink. Thanks be to God.
Just a quick reminder about communion. I think most of us know what we're doing, but just a quick reminder that today we'll be receiving communion in a little bit different way than we used to. Whatever aisle you are sitting on, that's the aisle you will both come forward and go back on. You'll be coming up kind of either as an individual if you're sitting by yourself, or as a family unit or a couple unit or whatever if you're sitting with other folks as well. Pastor John and I will indicate to you when it's time for you to come forward. You'll come forward, you'll receive communion. We have baskets at the top of each of the three rows that you'll be coming up, three aisles that you'll be coming up, that you can deposit the little prepackaged communion wafer cup thing that we have. Just a reminder about that little prepackaged cup thing, that when you're pulling it back, you'll pull back the cellophane first, leaving the foil layer behind. The cellophane layer gets you the bread. The foil layer will get you the grape juice wine portion afterwards. So, John, did I get everything? Okay, very good. If you have questions, hey, first time's always hard. If you have questions, just we'll play through together. So, there you go.
Friends, I'd invite you to rise as you are able. And let us pray. Gracious and abundant God, you have done great things for us, and we rejoice. In this bread and cup, you give us life forever. In your boundless mercy, strengthen us and open our hearts to the world's needs. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may God, the creator of the stars, bless your Advent waiting. May the long-expected Savior Jesus fill you with love. And may the unexpected Holy Spirit guide your journey now and forever. Amen. In peace, prepare the way of the Lord. Thanks be to God.